So hello and a really warm welcome to you all here today to our service. This is a communion service, so if you're at home and would like to participate, feel free to grab some bread or wine or something similar. Wherever and whenever you may be joining us, either in church or at home, in the morning or the evening, we are united as one through the Spirit as the body of Christ. We've all set aside this time to respond to the call of our hearts to seek the presence of God, and God delights in our searching and is faithful and loving in response. God is here, where we are right now. So let us take a moment to welcome him in our homes and in our church as he draws alongside us to listen, to guide, to comfort and instruct us. Father, we come to you today with all our strengths and all our weaknesses. Help us to quieten our minds. Help us to settle on your lap, to be still and know that you are God. You know us better than we know ourselves. You know better than us what we need and when we need it. We ask that through your Spirit, you may open our hearts to you and help us to receive all that you have to show us and to teach us this day. Through the power of the Spirit and in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So let us come to the Lord with praise and worship by singing in our hearts, or if at home, you can go for it and raise the roof. Come, now is the time to worship.
The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are. Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are. Still a great
Sees us entering into a new series for 4 weeks where we will be exploring corporate disciplines. Now, if the words corporate disciplines aren't filling you with excitement and anticipation, like my home group, don't turn off or fast forward or leave. Let me try and whet your appetite. Within our Christian traditions, we have a rich heritage of wisdom and of journeying. Since before the first disciples, we have had a yearning to find connection with a power greater than ourselves, a power we call God. Through Jesus, we have been granted the grace to have direct access to the divine, and generations before us have explored how best to do this. There are wisdom traditions going back centuries for us to learn from, to reframe and reclaim for ourselves in order that we too may fall more deeply into a relationship with our Father. The word discipline has been used to describe our involvement in the process of developing our relationship. It implies that it doesn't just happen. We have to make a conscious choice to follow Jesus. Relationships require commitment from both parties to grow and to flourish. First, let us clarify the word discipline. There are two forms that spring to my mind when I think of the word discipline. The first seems quite harsh. It can conjure up pictures of strict parents punishing their wayward children, or Dickensian teachers prowling round classrooms with rulers in hand. The second may elicit a picture of an athlete in training, sacrificing another sausage roll or a lion in order to get up and go to the track or to the pool. This type of discipline takes effort, time, and perseverance. You don't become a magnificent athlete overnight, unfortunately. How often I have heard myself use excuses as I struggle to maintain the motivation needed to commit to a certain way of living. I'm too tired. I've run out of time. I've always wanted to clear out and hoover that cutlery drawer. I'm the queen of excuses and procrastination. Never was this so evident to me as when I had an essay to be handed in. The word discipline used in these two ways have distinct differences, don't they? The first is discipline forced on us by some sort of authority. It's not our choice to participate in this. The second signifies a training regime taken on freely for a long-term personal benefit. The purpose of the second is generally a mastery of a field or for personal growth. Both kinds of discipline involve a rule or pattern of behaviours, but what motivates them is clearly very different. Spiritual disciplines are practices that help us to consciously develop the spiritual dimension to our lives. And as disciples, we are invested in this. They are opportunities of windows onto grace. They are an opportunity to lay ourselves bare in front of our loving, compassionate Father, who only desires to give us good things. If we are intent on deepening our relationship with the Creator of the universe, there is no better way to start than in asking God to give us this desire. A desire to draw close to Him, a desire to make Him the centre of our lives. Once we have this desire given to us by His grace, we have the motivation we need to commit to certain spiritual disciplines. Corporate disciplines are simply those that we do together. We may commit to personal disciplines like praying or meditating on scripture, but as the body of Christ, we commit to faithfully following certain disciplines as a fellowship. We have been operating over the last few months as a scattered people, and this will continue for a little bit longer yet, and trying to maintain a sense of community and solidarity amidst immense disruption, amidst fear and uncertainty. And there's a great strength to be gained by remembering that we are united in practicing these common corporate disciplines together. Although not always physically in the same place, we are held together through the Spirit and in the arms of our loving Father as we do so. So over the next 3 weeks, we will be looking at worship, guidance, and celebration. And this week we start by exploring confession. My very lovely mother-in-law, Mary Blowers, will now bring us our reading.
The reading this morning is taken from Nehemiah chapter 1, starting at verse 5 to verse 11. Then I said, O Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of unfailing love with those who love him and obey his commands. Listen to my prayer. Look down and see me praying night and day for your people, Israel. I confess that we have sinned against you. Yes, even my own family and I have sinned. We have sinned terribly by not obeying the commands, decrees and regulations that you gave us through your servant Moses. Please remember what you told your servant Moses. If you are unfaithful to me, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands and live by them, then even if you are exiled to the ends of the earth, I will bring you back to the place I have chosen for my name to be honoured. The people you rescued by your great power and strong hand are your servants. O Lord, please hear my prayer. Listen to the prayers of those of us who delight in honouring you. Please grant me success today by making the king favourable to me. Put it into his heart to be kind to me. The second reading is taken from 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14. Then, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and restore their land. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So, confession. What feelings does that stir up within you? Do you immediately start feeling guilty? Ashamed? Does it make you want to run away and hide? A good excuse for a duvet day, perhaps. Or do you feel that confession is maybe for others? Those who have done terrible, unspeakable acts of betrayal or violence. Nothing that we have done is that bad, that serious, is it? Or maybe the more you think about it, the more you're not really sure what confession is all about anyway. It all sounds a bit, well, you know, Catholic. If I'm honest, confession to me reminds me of my childhood. I'd do anything not to disappoint my mother. I'd rather lie, run away, or feign innocence before admitting I'd actually done anything wrong. I remember when we were moving from our council flat in a rather grotty part of Cambridge, and she was packing boxes. She was emptying a slidey cupboard that I used to sit next to when I was eating my tea. I was a very fussy eater. Nothing much has changed, my husband might say. But having been taken to the doctors on more than one occasion, because my mother was worried that I wasn't eating properly, she was a bit of a worrier. Anyway, as she slid back the doors to this brown, lovely 1970s formica cupboard, she happened upon a pile of fish fingers. Not wanting to upset her by not eating my tea, I had surreptitiously hidden them in the vague hope that she would never find them. When asked if I knew anything about the mysterious pile of uneaten debris, I declined to confess. We both knew it was me. There was only the two of us living there, but I was too ashamed to own up. So confession for me is linked to shame and guilt and the fear of not wanting to upset those that I love. It's linked to the fear that I'm not lovable if I do something wrong. But I have grown to believe that this not only harms my relationship with myself, but with the one who loves me the most. Confession is not about beating ourselves up. It's not about self-condemnation or false humility. It's about restoring a relationship. It is literally the crux of our faith. It's the mystery of the cross that through Jesus' action that day on Calvary, our sin, all sin for those who claim it, have been forgiven. We have to be brave and courageous and take a step of faith. We have to trust that God is not interested in hearing our sin in order to chastise, rebuke, or punish us. The story of the prodigal reminds us of this as he picks up his robes to run and embrace the returning disgraced son. He knows already what we have done or have not done, and he loves us anyway. We know nothing changes his love for us. This is about having the self-awareness to look in the mirror, see our flaws, see where we have gone astray, and come to our Father in sorrow. It's a chance to display honesty and vulnerability, not to push it under a rug and pretend we have it all together and that we're fine, but to sweep out the dirt, have a look at it, and ask for help to change. It's an opportunity to receive grace and the power to help us to be transformed. Home group for me is a place where I feel known, loved, and accepted for who I am. We have cultivated our relationships within this group over many years, and it has involved some tough conversations and some very vulnerable sharing of our stories. I would go as far to say that without this vulnerability, without this honesty, it's really hard, if not impossible, to deepen relationships. The same goes for our relationship with God. Our confessions need to come from a place of vulnerability and honesty, to be thought about and not hurried. There are times at the beginning of a service, sometimes when we can say the words of confession maybe a little bit by rote, without giving ourselves proper time to reflect deeply. We need space to examine our lives, our thoughts and our actions, and ask God to reveal to us those places and situations that require forgiveness. Confession is not about making God feel better. It's about us feeling better about ourselves. It's a grace moment of being able to pause, reflect, repent, and return to our lives with a renewed sense of identity and purpose. We can do this, of course, on our own, but there are times when we find it hard to feel like we're forgiven. We know God forgives us in our head, but it still nags us deep in our heart. In the Recovery 12-step program, there is a powerful moment when in step 4, you go through your life story, recognizing where and with whom you have gone wrong, where you've hurt people. Although you do this primarily on your own first, when you've completed writing it all down, you bring it to somebody. Somebody called your sponsor, someone who journeys with you through this process, and they go through it with you. You read it out loud, in full, in all its gory detail. And the very act of hearing the words, admitting the deeds in front of another person, can be overwhelmingly releasing. Then you burn it. If there is something that is unsettling your heart, that you have asked for forgiveness for, but you don't necessarily feel like you've been forgiven, then bringing it to someone can make all the difference in the world. This person doesn't have to be a priest, but I would be discerning to whom I shared my vulnerability and was that honest with. A wise, gentle, non-judgmental person who is further along the spiritual path than you, and someone in whom you have absolute trust, I think is essential. In the words of the great theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in the presence of another, the sin is brought into the light. It loses its power. It is dispelled. It is forgiven. So what is corporate about confession? So far, we've explored what confession is, but very much with a personal slant. The book that this series is based on is one by Richard Foster, entitled Celebration of Discipline. And one sentence that I read has really stuck with me. He writes, "Too often we view the believing community as a fellowship of saints before we see it as a fellowship of sinners. We are all in this together, this thing called life. We succeed and mess up in a never-ending pattern of birth, death, and resurrection. The society in which we live is great at always pointing us in a direction of success and how we can have more, be more, and accomplish more. There is nothing necessarily wrong with this, but it doesn't leave us an awful lot of room for messing up, for getting it wrong, for struggling, or, heaven forbid, actually failing. It's wonderful to see this slowly beginning to change as children are starting to get taught at an early age that failure teaches us more than winning. Resilience and perseverance are the current buzzwords in schools at the moment. But for some of us, it is harder to teach old dogs new tricks, especially as the world we operate in is not overtly tolerant of the also-rans. There is a tendency to think that everyone else has it all sorted. The perfect garden, family, the perfect job, perfect house and spouse. But get to know the person next to you well enough and you'll discover that we're just all trying to muddle through the best way we know how. Coming together, confessing together, being real and honest in front of God together reminds us that we're all in the same boat. We are all in need of forgiveness and restoration. Opening ourselves in this way, on our own or maybe with another, and when we come together as the body of Christ, we are putting ourselves in the way of God's grace and mercy to be restored and transformed. So now let us turn to our time of confession together. In a moment, we will have some music and some words to help us from Psalm 139. But first, we take our time and ask God to reveal anything that is getting in the way of our relationship with Him. We experience the godly sorrow that our thoughts, words, or actions have made us feel. But we don't dwell there in self-pity, shame, or self-condemnation. And we ask for the desire to change, to turn away from those thoughts, those words or actions that have harmed us, that have harmed others and our relationship with our Father.
Search me, know me, try me and see every worthless affection hidden in me. All I'm asking for is that clothe me in robes.
May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. And the prayer for today, the second Sunday of Creationtide. Lord of creation, whose glory is around and within us, open our eyes to your wonders, that we may serve you with reverence and know your peace at our life's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So let us continue in prayer as Keith will now lead us in our intercessions.
In our prayers, we will use the familiar Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer response. Let's pause for a moment to become quiet before the Lord as we prepare to bring our requests to him. Holy Father, our Saviour, Jesus the Messiah, and Holy Spirit of God, we bring our requests to you as you have told us to, continuing in prayer and never giving up. We also come with thankful hearts because of your great love for us, which we see so strongly in the sacrificial death of Jesus on a cross and in his resurrection. We pray for your church throughout the world, and in particular for the Anglican Communion and the Church of England. We pray for all church leaders, including Justin and Stephen, our archbishops, and especially their leadership in mission. Stephen Cottrell, the new Archbishop of York, has a particular concern for rebuilding the church's reputation following the poor handling of sexual abuse by clergy. We pray for him in the development of new processes of safeguarding and discipline. We also think of the deep divisions in the church over the question of homosexuality, and pray that you will deliver us all from a judgmental spirit and guide us through your Spirit's gift of prophecy to find the right way forward in faith, hope, and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our mission partners, Charlotte with World Horizons, Mim Friday with Viva, Vio and Emma Tulpan in Romania, and Bishop Sospita in Tanzania. Protect them spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and physically, and strengthen them in the work you have called them to do. We also pray for the staff and the work of Tear Fund, the YMCA, and the Bible Society. In all our mission partners, do, Lord, glorify your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, we have many things in the world to pray about. The results of coronavirus loom over everything. We pray for you to draw close to all who suffer from it. Especially we pray for those with long-term symptoms, for which the doctors have no understanding and no treatment. Will you bring healing, Lord? We pray for schools reopening while the pandemic persists, for the safety of children and staff, for any children who do not return at present, for wise leadership, and for real and effective learning to take place. We pray for the economy of our country as lockdown eases, that it will develop in new ways according to your will, with more effective sharing of the country's wealth. We pray for Rishi Sunak as he leads economic policy, We pray for proper support of the unemployed and proper rights and treatment for the employed. And we pray about Brexit, Lord, and its impact. Also for trade negotiations with the EU and other countries, that all agreements will be fair and just to both parties. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Another huge issue, O God, is climate change. It may herald your second coming, Lord Jesus, but in case it does not, we ask that we and all governments will work to change lifestyles that cause it for the benefit of all people. And then there is racism and the Black Lives Matter campaign. We pray that in North and South America and Europe, race and ethnicity will cease to have any bearing on how people are treated. In particular, Lord, we ask for this to apply to policing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Having prayed for schools in general, now we want to pray especially for the Wonersh and Shamley Green School, also our mission partner, as they reopen with a new head. We pray for Tim Cheeseman as he takes over from Tess, that he will continue to foster the strong commitment to Christ she developed, as well as all the other good things about the school. We pray for his own relationship with Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Also in our community, Lord, we want to pray for all those who are suffering, and particularly for any suffering from mental health problems or from loneliness. Bring them compassionate help and your healing. In a time of silence, please pray for anyone in need that you know of personally. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We come now to our time of communion. Although we are separated by space, we are united in and by the Spirit as we celebrate and remember the Last Supper, a simple meal with friends. Please join in with the words on the screen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." If you have bread and wine, you may like to take it now, as we symbolically share together, or simply stretch out your hands as we receive Jesus afresh this morning. With this bread that we break, we shall remember Jesus. With this wine that we take, we shall remember Jesus. Bread for his body, wine for his blood, gifts from God to his table we bring. We shall remember Jesus. Remember that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A couple of notices before we close. Wonersh will no longer be open for private prayer on Wednesday afternoon or before the service on Sunday. The main reason being that no one was coming, so it seems a little pointless. But St Martin's is still open in Blackheath if you want to find a beautiful quiet spot and some space to pray all day on Wednesday and on Sunday. Please do stay in touch with myself or David, and if anything has come up for you in the service today, we're only on the end of a phone or an email or a socially distanced cup of tea. So let us end with worship to our faithful God, in whom we trust and hope. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.